Good morning. Glad to see each one of you out this morning. If you're visiting with us, I want you to know you're an honored guest. And if you're one of our regular members, we're glad to have you this morning. Back in the foyer, if you're needing some assistance, there's some ushers back there. There's an unattended nursery, and there's a men's restroom on my left and a women's on the right. This time we'll turn our song service over to Brother Chris.
If you're willing, please stand with me for these first couple of songs. This first song, the first two songs are a song that we practiced during the singing class, and so I hope you'll be able to pick up on it pretty quickly. And then the third song, I think you'll know pretty well.
This is holy ground, we're standing on.
Father, we're thankful for this morning. We're thankful for the day you've given to us and the ability and the access that we can come together and worship you. We just pray that you would be with us as we go through this service, that you would help us to remember that we are here to worship you and give you all the honor and glory and praise that you deserve. Father, help us as we go through this service that we're singing to look at the words that we're saying, to understand what we're saying, and that we can gain insight and lessons just from the songs that we sing, that we can encourage each other by doing so. Father, we're most of all thankful for your Son. Thankful that he was willing and that you were willing to let him come to this earth, that he was able to live a perfect life and then sacrifice himself for us to pay a debt that we have no way to pay back to you. We're just so thankful for that. Thankful for the hope and the peace that we have and the blessings that we have through his death and his resurrection, that we can be resurrected just like he was someday. Father, we know there's many that are not here this morning that are sick and have things going on in their lives that kept them away, and we just pray that you be with them. If it be your will, that you would heal them, give them the health back that they desire to have, and help us to understand that you know better than we do, that you will give them what they need. It may not always be what we want, but you know what they need, and you give us the things that we need. Again, be with us as we go through the service this morning. Help us to have our minds focused on you, to put those things and our thoughts and our worries and our cares and our worldly things away for this few moments that we can just focus solely on you. Be with Tom as he delivers the lesson this morning and help him to present those things that we can see them and understand them and use them in our life. And that we can use those things that we know and we can teach others about you. We can bring more people to you so that they can know that you do love them, that you want to be with them and you want them to be with you. Again, thank you most of all for your son. And it's through his name we pray. Amen.
On the first day of the week, each and every week, we're commanded to remember our Lord and Savior's death as he died for us. This is something that we do. If you read Acts 20, verse 7, now on the first day of the week, the disciples assembled to break bread. They do this every first day of the week, just as we're commanded. We want to remember Jesus, the love he had for us, that he went to the cross and he was beaten and he was abused and he was tortured. He was ultimately killed on the cross for our sins. As Tom said in our class this morning, Jesus did no sin, but he paid for the sins of the world with his life. If you will, bow with me and we'll give thanks for the loaf. Loving Father, we're indeed in awe of the price that was paid for our sins. As we surround this table this morning, Father, and remember Jesus' death for us, we pray that you'll bless the loaf, that we'll draw our minds back to the cross and remember the cruel torture that he succumbed to for our sins. And that we might take of this loaf, Father, in a manner that's pleasing in your sight. In Christ's precious name we pray. Amen. Bow with me. In like manner, Father, we pray your blessings on this cup, which represents Christ's blood that was poured out on the cross. We pray, Father, that you'll be with us as we remember our Savior. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Separate and apart from the Lord's Supper, we're commanded on the first day of the week to lay by in store and give back a portion we've earned. All the money that we put in the collection plate here goes to further the work of the Lord. It's been said many times, we don't store up money, we don't have a massive bank account. When the needs arise, we use the money that's been given for that work, and we put it to work. We believe that we're commanded to be generous towards the church, and not as an afterthought. We're supposed to think of what we're going to give, and purpose that in our heart before the actual doing of it. Is something that we're commanded to do also on the first day of the week. Let's give thanks for the blessings we have. Heavenly Father, we know that we're indeed a blessed people to live in this country, the most successful country in the world. We're grateful, Father, for us being able to live here and have the freedoms that we have, especially the freedoms to worship you. And we pray, Father, that we'll always give ample thought to how we can help to support your work, spreading the gospel worldwide, supporting the local ministry. We know, Father, that we're indeed so financially blessed, and we realize our obligation to give back to you. We pray you'll bless our giving. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Listen to the wondrous story, and they want some among us, and bring it from heaven's glory.
For our scripture reading and Tom's lesson this morning, if you want to mark the song of encouragement, it'll be number 714, Trust and Obey. But our song before the lesson will be number 527. If you will, please join me in standing again if you're up to 527.
As I travel through life,
reading today will come from Luke 2, 52. Luke chapter 2, verse 52. And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men.
Thank you, Nathan. Thank you, Chris. Great job in leading singing. Good morning to everybody.
Good morning.
Let's see those Bibles. All right, God bless you for bringing those Bibles. I mentioned this in class, but I want to mention this to the whole church, that there is a highlighted list lying in the foyer. The blue represents people postcards are being sent to for the 185th anniversary. We want to see if you have anybody else that you would like to send a note to. It's in alphabetical order. A posted pad is laying there to add names and addresses to. We're up to around 300. We're just ready to get as many more as is humanly possible. We're just a few weeks away, so we need to do our part in making this not only a great Lord's Day, which every day is, but a day in the afternoon, a little bit about the history of this church for 185 years. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the time that you've given us today to be in worship. We're grateful, Father, for the expressions of worship we've already participated in, and to open up the Holy Bible and study truths that are applicable to our life, we're grateful. And we trust, hope, and pray that the message today will rest and lodge in hearts that are open, honest, sincere, receptive, helpful, and useful as your word is shared today. We know we have those who can't be with us due to illness, and we miss them. We miss those who are traveling. We know that school starts this week, and there are those who are still away, but as school begins, as we prayed fervently on Friday night, we pray for all those who are involved, public, private schools, all teachers, administrators, students, helpers, staff. We pray, dear God, that our folks can be an example in a very positive way. We're prayerful today, Father, of families and stresses and difficulties in rearing and raising children. We pray that this message might be beneficial and helpful to those who have come. Forgive us, help us, and use us. And finally, forgive us. In Jesus' name we pray our prayer. Amen. Well, if you remember, a few weeks ago, we began a four-part series on stress. And the first lesson was damaged but not destroyed from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, 7 through 10. And then we looked at Martha, Martha, why are you so troubled? And we gave the RX in Philippians chapter 4, 4 through 9. And then the lesson that has become the famous, or maybe the infamous, lesson on marriage and stress, the drip and the drip. And you, as a spouse, you don't want to be that drip, continuously complaining. You don't want to be that. And so after a few weeks, we're back to our final lesson today, and we want to talk about stress and young people. You know, we could talk about stress in the workplace or health problems or personal relationships, and if it goes unchecked, then we're going to have some headaches, we're going to have some fatigue, we're going to have some sleep issues, we're going to have some anxiety, we're going to have some depression. Stress is real. And physicians would tell you that, and nurse practitioners would tell you that. Today, our focus is on kids and stress. You know, there's a scripture that most of us are familiar with in Proverbs 22:6. It says this, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. As parents and grandparents, we train and do our best and hope for the future. That's all that we can do. And I want you to notice how this scripture is worded, because I've had people tell me over the years, well, Proverbs 22:6, I did all of that, but look how my kids turned out. And I said, the Bible says, train up a child in the way he should go. Should go. Doesn't say will go, but the way that he should go. If he has that foundation, he has those spiritual moorings in the way that he should go. Maybe, hopefully, sometime he'll come back or she'll come back to those spiritual applications and principles that we gave as we were rearing and raising those children. Proverbs 22:6 is helpful and powerful. You know, it might be good this morning to just stop and talk about some stages and ages. You know, what are we talking about when we talk about youth and young people? Here's what we're talking about. We're talking about infants. And we know that infants are 24/7. We know that it's just a time of neediness. They're so needy, and they cling to you like a magnet. Then there are the preschoolers. Me, 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 mine, that's mine. Don't take my toy. That belongs to me, all right? And then there are the grade schoolers. Let's just go, you know. Grade schoolers, they just want to go all the time, all right? That's what they want to do, all right? Middle schoolers. A lot of changes are taking place in that body and in that mind. And the emotions are running rampant. For high schoolers, it's all about definitions. And for high schoolers, it might be more about this. Let me go in my room and close the door. Leave me alone. There are all those stages and all those ages. And just like we did in our lesson on marriage, we're going to talk about how do we bless the mess. But before I do that, let me give you a quick little humor story of children and how they think and what they write down sometimes on their papers. A teacher asked some students and this is the way one little six-year-old boy answered his. Who is your hero? And he wrote in those great big letters, D-A-D, Dad. Why is Dad your hero? He wrote in great big letters, Brave, B-R-A-V-E. Is there anything at all that your dad is afraid of? He wrote in great big letters, M-O-M. When you ask questions, you don't ever know what you're going to get. But how do we, in 2023, with all the pressure and the stress and the external, the internal forces out there, how do we help kids and stress? Well, the first thing that a parent has to do, or a grandparent, or somebody who's in charge as a guardian of that child, in front of them is to be real. As we go to the book of Deuteronomy, there are so many helpful principles in Deuteronomy. I love to begin in 4:9, and then we'll look at 6:1-9. 4:9 says this, only take heed to yourself and diligently keep yourself, lest you forget the things your eyes have seen, and lest they depart from your heart all the days of your life, and teach them to your children and your grandchildren. 6:1-9 is famous, familiar to most of us. We'll start in verse 4 with the Shema, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your strength. And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children. You shall talk of them when they sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. What Moses is suggesting to parents and grandparents and guardians and mentors is God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit, the Word of God must be in that home every single day. Don't leave your Bibles in the pew. Don't wait till Sunday or Wednesday to pick up that Bible. You know, those young people see that. Be real. Allow that Bible to not just be a page, but let that Bible come alive. Help them to understand that these principles, these values, these truths will last forever and ever and ever. How hard is it sometimes to be real? This guy went into the military. He was working himself up the chain of command. He heard a knock on the door. He knew that it was one of his superiors. As the man walked through the door, the guy picked up his telephone. It wasn't a cell phone. He picked up his telephone. And he said, Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir, General. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'll do that, sir. Yes, sir. And he hung up the phone. And the guy who came in the door said, I've come to hook up your phone. Be real. That's what young people are looking for. That's what adolescents, teenagers, young adults, that's what they're looking for in parents and grandparents and mentors. Be real. That's what they want. Let them see you make mistakes. And let them see you correct your mistakes. Let them see you love God with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second is likened to it, to treat people the way that they need to be treated. That's part of the golden rule. Be real. Number two, watch the window of salvation. If you have a young person who is at the age of 19 and they've never become a Christian, really watch the window there. Because a lot of times when they leave home, that window shuts and so does the door. That's why Timothy talked about his mother and his grandmother and the great influence they had in his life. And that's why when you read 2 Timothy chapter 3:15, it says this, and that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which incidentally are able to make you wise unto or for salvation. That's why we encourage families to bring their children to Sunday school and to Bible class and give them an opportunity to learn truths and lessons that will stay with them forever and ever and ever. A child will never forget the story of David and Goliath. They won't forget that. It'll be indelibly in their heart and in their head because of the message behind it. So we want to make sure that we watch that window of salvation and be talking to our young people about Jesus and be telling them about the importance of being a follower of Jesus. I talked to my class today that the word Christian is only found 3 times in the Bible, but the word disciple is found numerous times in the Bible. And we are called upon not just to be a follower of Christ, but a follower of Christ that becomes a disciple of Christ that is trying to be what Jesus was in his life. And so we need to teach them very, very early and very, very long through those years. And don't let that window shut or that door shut totally and completely. I'm not saying that they never will. I'm just simply saying that the odds are once they get past the age of 19 and they leave home and they go to college or university, go to trade school or begin their job and they're away from the influence of their mom and daddy, a lot of times it doesn't look too good. Number three, wrap your child up in a blanket of prayer. Let's go to the book of 1 Samuel. You have your Bibles? Let's go to the book of 1 Samuel. I want to read a few verses here because Hannah was a lady who used prayer and the avenue of prayer so very powerfully. And I want you to see it. She had a vow in verse 8 of chapter 1. And we get down to verse 10. And she was in bitterness of soul. She prayed to the Lord and wept in anguish. Now stop and think about this for a minute. What kind of prayer is that? I'm here to tell you that is a prayer of earnestness. That is a prayer of fervency. That is a prayer that you have a fervent spirit when you're doing that. And probably you are just so broken that you may be down here and you are petitioning God. And the way that these early Christians prayed is they prayed with hands out, God, God. That was the way they were praying. And maybe Hannah was saying, listen, God, I want a child. And I'm praying about it. I'm beseeching you for it. And I'm weeping in bitterness and anguish for this. Was Hannah's prayer received? Was Hannah's prayer answered? Verse 12 says, and it happened as she continued praying before the Lord. Now, she didn't just pray once. She didn't just weep bitterly once. She didn't just to God once. She continued praying. It's not enough to ask God one time. We have to ask God continuously about our children and our young people over and over and over and over and over and then over again. She continued praying. I like starting one. And Hannah prayed again and said, my heart rejoices in the Lord. My horn is exalted in the Lord. I smile at my enemies because I rejoice in your salvation. Watch two. No one is holy like the Lord. There is none besides you. Nor is there any rock like our God. Prayed and prayed and prayed. Go down to chapter 2, verse 18. It says, and Samuel ministered before the Lord, even as a child, wearing a linen ephod. Even as a child, he was ministering to the Lord. Children can sometimes do what we can't. And children many times do what we can't. When you really stop and think about it, one of the ways that we are effective in Bible camp and Family Vacation Bible School is getting to the parent through the heart of those children. As they listen and learn and glean and enjoy, I want to come back. I want to hear some more. Hannah, cloaked in prayer concerning Samuel. And you read as much as you want to about it in 1 through 21, but I just want to pick out one particular verse in chapter 2, and that's verse 26. And I want you to see how this relates to something about Jesus, as Nathan read to us a few minutes ago in Luke 2:52. But look at 2:26. And the child Samuel grew in stature and in favor with the Lord and with men. If you want to pray a prayer for your children or your grandchildren, your nieces, your nephews, people that you can mentor, people that you can be an influence in their lives, why don't you pray 2:26? That our children will not only grow in stature, but they'll grow in favor with the Lord and with men. Let me leave you with these two final thoughts about every stage and age. You know, we talked about this in class a week or two ago. There's not a whole lot about Jesus between the ages of 12 and 29. There's just a gap there that's missing that the Holy Spirit did not intend for us to know in Jesus' life. But I tell you what he was doing, Luke 2:52. He was growing in stature. He was growing emotionally. He was growing physically. He was growing socially. And he was growing spiritually. That's what Jesus was doing between the ages of 12 and 29. That's what he was doing. He was getting prepared for his ministry. And in his ministry is where he began to make a difference in people's lives. So these are the ways that we want our children to grow. And with all of the pressure and of all of the stress that are in the minds and hearts of our young people, even this week as they get ready for school again, another school year, and as all of the teachers and helpers and administrators get ready for another year of school again, we're going to make sure that our children are growing physically. It's normal. But that they're growing emotionally and mentally and socially. But more than that, they're growing in favor with God and man. You see, that goes all the way back to Matthew 22:37-39 and Mark 12:29-31. And that goes back to what we read in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 5 and following. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength. The second is likened to it. Love your neighbor as yourself. We have to teach our children to love our fellow man, to love their neighbor. So many kids Wednesday will be laughed at. They'll be mocked. They'll be jeered. They'll be made fun of. You know why? Because they don't wear some of the clothes the other kids do. They can't afford it. Their shoes are not the very best tennis shoes that man can buy, so they're going to be made fun of. It may be that over the course of time, something has happened to them where their face has become a little bit disfigured. They're going to be laughed at and mocked. We've got to teach our children to be bigger than that and not allow them to be like that toward other people. When you go to Psalm 127, the psalmist gave us some, I think, parting thoughts here in our lesson today, and I'd like for you to go to Psalm 127, and I'll just read the psalm together. It's only about five verses, so if you will, in your Bible, Psalm 127. And here is what the psalmist said. Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord guards or protects the city, it is vain for you to rise up early, to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows. for he gives his beloved sleep or rest or peace. Now watch 3 through 5. Watch 3 through 5. Behold, children are a heritage from the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward. That really knocks abortion down, doesn't it? Like arrows in the hands of a warrior, so are the children of one's youth. Happy is the man who has his quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed. What is a quiver? What it was in that day and time, when the warrior went out, he had a shield or a case. And that's what he put his arrows in. And he put just as many arrows in there as he thought he was going to need, necessary for what the hunt and protection might call for. And you know what the psalmist said? Blessed is the man who has a house full of children. Victoria, you remember those days, don't you? All those siblings that you had, and you all had such a wonderful time and such a wonderful life. You don't see those big families anymore like you used to. It's just something that's not done any longer. But the psalmist said, blessed is the man who has a house full of them. When we look back at all the ages and the stages of life that we went through, from the very least, that needy stage won't last forever. That next stage of me, my, and mine, Cody, that won't last forever. It passes by so very quickly. As you think about that, middle school years are so testing and trying, and they soon get to be high schoolers. We got to teach them to be independent. That's the whole goal, to be on their own, to be able to make responsible decisions, but not forget God in the process. And then these young adults who are trying to make their way now. And as they try to make their way, sometimes they try to make a living more than they do a life. We have to teach them, come back. Making a life with God is more important than trying to chase the almighty dollar that you don't necessarily have to have in your pursuit of happiness. So this morning, we close our four-part series on stress. Do you have it? Maybe today you're going to give it to God. All right, you're just going to give it to God. He has bigger shoulders than you do, bigger shoulders than I do. I'm going to give my stresses to God. I'm going to give my stresses to God, let him handle it. And if I'm not a Christian and I become a Christian, then I have an access to tell God, listen, God, I've got some stresses. You already know what they are, but I'm going to tell you what they are. And God wants to hear, and he wants to hear from you. So this morning, you can either become a Christian and have everything wiped clean, or you could come and say, I've got some stresses. I want to give them to God. As I trust and obey, because there's no other way to be happy but to trust and obey. Chris, while we sing.
When we walk with the Lord.
morning. Just a few announcements here. I was given a note that says, please remember the Stanley Vincent family. He passed away this morning. His wife, Virginia, attends the Penn's Chapel congregation, so please remember that family. Also, I was given a card to read from Elizabeth Kemp. It says, Mount Pleasant family, thank you for all your love and support during my mother's illness and in her final days of passing. Thank you for the cards, gift cards, visits, and mostly your prayers. Your love for God and love for my family was most definitely seen and felt during such difficult days. I'm humbled to love Elizabeth Kemp. Also, remember the Shine at Three Forks congregation on August the 19th at 9 a.m. Registration is available on our Facebook, so if you're interested in that. Also, on August the 20th, 2 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall, Josh Clemens and Jeanette Guzman's wedding shower, so please remember that as well. And don't forget our preparations for the 185th anniversary coming up. There's some other meeting announcements and such that's in your bulletin, so, and also a sick list of those that need our prayers due to physical infirmities, so if you will please pay attention to that as well. If you have any other announcements that need to be made, if you'll get those to me, we'll make those this evening.
Thank you all for being here and for singing out so well this morning. If you will, please join me in standing. We'll sing a few verses of this song and be dismissed with prayer.
Each day I believe.
Let's pray together. Our dearest Father in heaven, Lord, we are so thankful for today, Father. We're so thankful for the rain that we've had recently, and especially the sunshine, as both a reminder of your creation and your omnipotence in our life, Father. We are so thankful for another Lord's Day that we have to come and worship you, to learn more about you, Father, that we can be together as a church family and friends, that we can gather together just to be an encouragement to those around us. Lord, we pray as we go throughout this week, Father, that we will be good servants of your word and not hearers only, Father. Lord, as we prayed many times on Friday, as Tom spoke about today, We want to make mention of those kids who start school this week. That is our biggest prayer this morning, I feel like, because this world is getting harder and harder, it seems, especially in my lifetime and those who surround me, Father. Lord, we pray that you will watch over these kids as they go throughout their new journey in the school life. Lord, we don't know what they have to endure, truly, Father, but we pray that we can be an encouragement to them, that we can motivate them to be good lights, especially the ones who are of the church, that they can bring others to church, Father. Lord, we pray as Christians that we can just be a servant, that we can go out into this world and make it a better place. It will never be perfect, Father, until the day that you return and take us home with you. Lord, we pray that you'll watch out for us and bring us back tonight. And we're so thankful for the love that's in this room. Be with us and strengthen us when we fail you. It's through your Son's name that we pray. Amen. Amen.